Let's get started. This is an introduction to webOS. I am Josh Marinacci. I'm an engineer in the developer relations team. And they edited my slides. That's today's date. First, I'd like to, we've got a 1 hour session, but we're going to go pretty much all day. We'll have some breaks and lunch. We're going to give you a full overview of the entire webOS platform, ecosystem, all the pieces you need to know. I'm not going to get too in-depth in any particular piece, but this will let you see everything that's there and decide which sessions you want to go to tomorrow. So if you want to learn more about Aries, there's an Aries session tomorrow. If you want to learn more about the PDK, there's several PDK sessions tomorrow. We're going to cover the architecture of the webOS itself, the application architecture. Drop into some actual code and build an app on stage, and go over Aries a little bit, and then talk about the advanced APIs. And finally, the app catalog, the most important part of our platform, because that's where you guys can sell your apps and make money. And you do not need anything more than basic programming and HTML skills. Everything else we are going to teach you today and tomorrow. But our goal is that by the end of this weekend, you will be able to build your own app and put it in the catalog and start making some money. So first, a little bit about me. I'm actually a Java programmer by trade. I was at Sun Microsystems for 5 years until the Oracle acquisition. I wrote swing hacks for O'Reilly. I worked on the JavaFX project, the Java Store, and the Swing Windows look and feel. My entire professional career has been user interfaces. I really care about user interfaces, making sure that they're attractive, that they're productive, and high quality. And for a long time, I've been very negative towards web technology. Because JavaScript is slow, any serious interaction requires page refreshes, which is slow. Everything is dependent on a server. There's no access to local resources. The web always felt like a very limited thing, a step backwards from everything we gained on the desktop in terms of usability and interaction. And it's good for very text-heavy documents, but it wasn't great for things that had a lot of graphics and interaction. And it was always dependent on the server, which seemed like the weakest part. Well, I was wrong, or rather, the web has changed a lot since I first was really diving into it with JSPs and servlets. Probably Google Maps is the first big application I remember using Ajax that was truly felt interactive, like something that you could have done on a desktop because you could actually slide and pan the images. And it used asynchronous JavaScript calls so it could connect to the server without reloading the page. That was the beginning. And it has just continued moving on since then. So last November, I happened to meet Ben and Dion at the OrDev conference in Sweden. And yes, I had to go all the way across the halfway around the world to meet with people in my own time zone. But such is the life and technology. So I went to their presentation. I was really impressed with how far web technologies have come, with the amount of companies and money being poured into improving them, HTML5 becoming reality, new JavaScript engines, new web browser renderers, things to really push it forward, and defining new standards to access local resources. The web has become an all-encompassing software development platform that is capable of truly unique and interactive interfaces. Ajax was the beginning of that, and more has been coming along. While I still think the Java virtual machine is a great technology, it has never really played well with the rest of the web. And the great thing about web technology, of course, is that it's open. No one company controls it. Google doesn't. Even Apple doesn't. It's perhaps the only open technology you can use to build iPad applications. And so that's really why I joined Palm, because this needs to be a platform that everybody can work together on. And Palm chose the web as the core DNA of the webOS and, of course, put it in the name. So what is the webOS? It's our mobile operating system. We used to have an OS called Palm OS, which this has no connection to. We completely scrapped it. There is an emulator you can use, but it was all completely rewritten from scratch. Designed from the ground up to be a mobile operating system, not necessarily for cell phones. That's currently what we sell, but in the future, there may be other form factors and devices. We always assumed that there would be multiple screen sizes, and you can already see that with the difference between the Pre and the Pixie. So the operating system was designed to scale to many different form factors, but still presenting to you, the software developer, a uniform platform for you to build on. Currently, we have the Pre and the Pixie. Their hardware is roughly equivalent. The Pre has a larger screen. It's the same number of pixels wide, though this is physically a tiny bit narrower, so the pixels are actually smaller. But same number of pixels wide, and I think 80 pixels shorter on the Pixie versus the Pre. But it's very easy to make your software adapt to that. And in fact, with some of the stuff I'll show you later, it's completely automatic. No different than writing an app where you resize the browser window. The CPU is a little bit faster on the Pre, same with the GPU, but they run the exact same software. So when someone chooses one phone over the other, it's do they like the weight? Do they want that to slide or to always have the buttons out? It's a preference thing. And again, for you, the software developer, it's a uniform platform. So when we started designing the webOS, from the beginning, we wanted it to be built with the DNA of the web. The SDK, not one SDK, the SDK is HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, which are the core languages of the web. You can use any JavaScript libraries you want. We provide some, but you know, if you want to use Moodle tools or jQuery or some little thing you found on a web server in the Czech Republic, which I found last night, it should work. We provide JavaScript APIs for the core operating system functionality for things like access to the camera and the address book location stored. And we are tracking the HTML5 standards. HTML5 isn't done yet, but we can see where it's going, and we're tracking them. And in many cases, we are implementing those APIs, or we're planning to migrate our APIs towards the standard. Our goal is not for this to be a proprietary platform. It's part of the web, and it should meet web standards as much as possible and continue to improve over time. So this is our basic architecture. I should mention, you don't need to write this down. We're going to put all the slides up on the web. And this isn't that important for you to understand where the Linux kernel is and the drivers. This is just, you know, if you're curious. Essentially, the bottom half of the operating system is a Linux stack. Here's Linux kernel, file system, TCP/IP, you know, bog standard stuff. All of the actual services, playing media, the middleware, everything is primarily C-based services, which are exposed to the application developer through JavaScript APIs on our Palm bus here. And so that's what gives you access to app services and the cloud services. Now, on top of that is our Windows server, which is called Luna. So occasionally in the docs, you'll see somebody reference Luna. That's essentially the top half of the UI. It actually moves the Windows around and contains the browsing core, the HTML rendering core, which is built on WebKit. Then your applications can use the Mojo framework, which is entirely JavaScript-based. And that's what gives you the common look and feel, all of the standard widgets that look the same in all applications, so your app feels like it belongs on the phone. And then above accessing those APIs is your actual app itself. The applications themselves. Now, we say it's built with web technology. That does not mean you have a little web server sitting inside your phone. Everything is local. It's HTML and JavaScript and CSS and images on disk, bundled up into essentially a zip file, which represents your application. Applications can have stages, which contain scenes, which contain widgets. So that's a nice big hierarchy. You have one app, it has one or more stages, which can have one or more scenes, and one or more widgets. And it's important to understand the difference between stages and scenes, because this will reflect how you design your application from the user's point of view. So a stage is a card. You can think of it as like an actual physical card. And for those of you who have Palm devices or have used them, you know that card is the core metaphor. When you're flipping between applications, you're flipping from one card to another. Most applications have one stage, but multiple scenes. For example, this is the email app. When you start up, you'll probably be at the screen. This is your inbox. So there's one card, which is the stage, containing one scene, which is the inbox. Now, if you click on something, it's going to come here. This loads up a new scene. And usually, you'll see a transition between the two. But it's still in the same card. So if I went out to the multitask view, I'd only see one actual rounded card. Now, if I press this button and create a new email message, because that's a task that I want to do separately from continuing to browse my inbox, it opens up a new stage. So now my app has two stages. You can see the edge of the inbox here, and this is the new stage for the new email. And you have to have at least one stage, but you can have more than one where it's appropriate. In terms of implementation, a stage is a card, which is essentially a single HTML document. So you can think of a stage as like a tab in your browser. It's one page. And you can jump between pages, but you've only got one open at a time. And then by if you hit a link with the, what is it, underscore blank, it opens up a new actual window or tab, which is a separate, concurrently existing document. Here, again, another pretty diagram. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. From your point of view, what really matters is when a scene is created, it's initialized, and then its setup method is called. And we have little scripts that will generate templates for you, and this will be filled in with some nice little docs describing what you should put there. In your setup, you're going to actually set up your scene, meaning you're going to initialize your widget, set up event listeners, connect to data, and then when it's actually shown on screen, usually right after it's been set up, activate will be called. And then if the user switches to a new scene or over to a new card, deactivate will be called. And then when it's time to finally get rid of that scene completely, cleanup will be called. And it's important you remove anything you don't want to leak garbage right here. So event listeners, open network connections, that sort of thing. So that's stages and scenes. Now we have widgets. All of the widgets, as I said, are built in JavaScript. They are all built on the model view controller design pattern. The view is HTML and CSS, which I'll show you in a second. The controller, we call them assistants, and that's the actual JavaScript logic where you put in your event handlers, where the logic of your application goes. Then there's models. Most of the widgets have models built into them that you can reuse. So you only need to create a separate model when you need to do something special. And in a lot of applications, you'll maybe have one model for your core data structure. And then individual widgets just use the models built into them. So this is what a view looks like. There's an HTML page, and every widget is essentially a div. So in this case, I have two buttons. I gave them IDs. So if you've done web development, this should look pretty familiar. The class is used for styling. So the one up there, I say this should be drawn as a palm button. The one down here is also a palm button, but you can see I added a second class called negative. That says I want the particular variant of palm button, which is negative, which is drawn differently. And then the text that's actually going to be in the button is inside the div. So I'm tired of Hello World programs. I created a Destroy World program. So we have activate, the nuclear device, and then destroy. So if I don't add any code to it, I just pop this up on the screen. That's what it will look like. That's the standard palm button, activate, and then the one with the negative attribute on it is destroy. It doesn't change the functionality at all. It's just a different style that's used to semantically indicate to the user that something important is going to happen. For example, if you press this button, it's going to destroy the world. So don't do this just on a whim. We've colored it red, so you're aware it's a more significant action. So let's add a little code behind that. This will go in the assistant, And you can see this is the activate scene. So it says activate assistant.prototype.setup. And the setup function is where you're going to do all of your basic initialization. So I have an event handler, which is down here, destroy planet, which conveniently logs to the console telling me what I'm doing. I've turned that into an event handler with the bind as event listener and stored in planet destroy planet handler. And then attach it, and this is the core Mojo API. This.controller.listen, so that is the ID that was back here, my destroy button. And then we say on mojo.eventTap. There's a bunch of very specific events that we have defined beyond what's built into the DOM itself for things like touch events. So all the different ways you could click on something or encapsulate in tap. There's also multi-touch events. There's accelerometer events, all sorts of events that aren't on a typical web page. We define new events, and you can just attach listeners for them. So when tap happens on my destroy button, this will be called, and my logging will be executed. And again, be sure to clean up your references. So you'll need to unlisten to this listener right there, or you could have a memory leak until the app is completely closed. APIs. So there's a whole bunch of APIs in the platform. I can't possibly go through them all today, because you probably do want to sleep some before we get back together tomorrow. All the APIs are provided in JavaScript. There's basic application APIs, like the address book and calendar, access to local storage. Network services, there's the standard ones built into the browser environment. But we also provide some additional ones for uploading and downloading with progress detection. So you can, say, take a picture with the camera and then upload it and find out if the upload failed or succeeded or how far along it's gone to show results to the user. And then, of course, all the hardware features have their own APIs. This is a very simple API request to open an email. In this case, we're saying this.controller, and you're going to see all over the place, this.controller. Remember I said that the code has an assistant, that's our controller? The assistant is actually assisting the real controller. Every stage, every scene has something called a controller. Scenes have a scene controller, and then it delegates certain behavior to the assistant, which is the code that you write. So if you want a reference to that controller, you say this.controller, and then you can access the full Mojo API. So, yes?
Can you specify what controller?
It's always the controller that you're in. So if you wanted, there are methods to get a handle of another controller. Like if you had another scene elsewhere that you wanted to interact with, there are methods to get a reference to that. But by default, your code is encapsulated, so you only have a reference to the scene that you're actually in. Pretty much all the APIs have a very similar structure in that you're going to make a service request or some other request, the name of the service, and then a bunch of parameters as a JSON object. So in this case, we're going to call the application manager, and we're going to say we want it to open. What do we want it to open? The email. So in the parameters, we give it an ID, com.palm.app.email. That's the actual package name of the email app. And we're going to call the open method on it. And then we give it some parameters. There's the summary, that's the body, no, excuse me, that's the subject line, and then the body, and then the recipients. And since it's destroying the world, we'll send it to Marvin the Martian. This is the network access. In this case, I'm going to use the download manager. Let me see if I remember which one this is. Okay, so I'm going to upload a photo to Twitter. Very similar structure. I'm going to call the download manager, give it the method of upload, and then a bunch of parameters describing the file name on disk, the URL I'm sending it to, what the content type is, and the post parameters. In this case, there's a web service on TwitPic which will take my username and password and a photo and then submit it to Twitter for me along with a message. And then subscribe: true. This is kind of subtle, but it's important to notice. in regular AJAX calls, you make a request, and then it comes back when it's done once. So it either failed or succeeded, and you're going to get one of your callbacks will be called back once. If you have subscribe true, some of these APIs can give you multiple callbacks, which is how you can get progress during the transaction. So in this case, I probably don't actually need it there because I only care if it succeeded or failed. So I pass in two event handlers. On success is this function, on failure is this other function. Hardware access, again, very similar API structure. In this case, I'm in the scene, so this.controller is my scene controller. Then I want its parent, which is the stage controller, and then I'm going to push scene. So the API for camera is slightly different. Rather than simply giving you a reference to the camera and that you call a method on, there's actually a whole special user interface for the camera that has the button and to take the picture and control over the flash and does the real-time preview. It is essentially a scene unto itself, but a scene that you can insert into your application. So rather than calling a method on the camera, we are going to make the user navigate to the camera scene. And that's what push scene does. The scenes are sort of like a stack. So here's my first scene, and then the user can navigate down. So like in the email app, I'm on the inbox, and then we push a new scene on top for the list of all the messages, and then a new scene for the message that I'm viewing right now. And then, so we use push scene for that, and then when you go back down the stack, it's pop scene. So for this, we're going to push scene to the camera, give it the name capture, saying we want it to open up to the capture scene in the camera app. And then this is the file name that we want it to use when the user has taken a picture. So now I know where that picture is, and I can do something to it, like upload it to Twitter. So even though it's slightly different, again, it's the same basic structure. Here's a method with a bunch of JSON parameters, and then there's callbacks. Oh, and I should say, in this case, we didn't provide a direct callback because it is a new scene. When the scene is popped off, this scene will be activated again. And so that's how we know that the user came back, and I can check for status if they actually took a picture or canceled instead. So that is the core structure of applications, all written in JavaScript, HTML, CSS. There is something called the PDK, and I'm not going to cover it very much today. It's the plugin development kit, much like in desktop web browsers. There are certain things that you can't do or can't do yet with a browser all by itself, so you have plugins for it. The plugin development kit lets you create plugins for our browser, essentially, plugins that exist in your application. The upside is you can write in C and C++. You have direct access to the underlying Linux layer, so you have all the POSIX APIs. You can read and write files, raw socket access, use native C libraries, everything you would expect. You have direct access to the screen through OpenGL and SDL, which are standard graphics APIs, and something we call the PDL, which gives you access to specific APIs from Palm. And you can also, most of the games you've seen in our catalog that are the 3D games, those were all done with the PDK. They are full screen applications, but we're also working on something called a hybrid application, where a portion of the screen or a headless part of the screen would be implemented in C, and the rest of your application would be in JavaScript with Mojo, so that you can mix and match the two. We do have the SDK available right now. You can download it. We are not yet accepting apps built with this. You can submit it, but you'll get a rejection notice until we have a software update to fully enable it on actual phones in the field. You can test it on your local phone, but there's still a few bugs to work out. We're expecting that to be later in the summer. So that's probably all I'm going to cover about the PDK today. If you want to learn more, we're going to have several sessions tomorrow. In fact, I think that's on our agenda here, right? Where's my mouse cursor? There we go. WebOS, JavaScript, P, PDK hybrid applications is tomorrow at 11:55. And game development using simple direct media layers, even if you don't know actual OpenGL, which is very low level, there's a whole lot you can do with the SDL layer. And we'll get more into to different kinds of stages tomorrow, and then more on the 3D hardware. So there's a ton of stuff tomorrow. Again, I suggest you take notes and figure out what you want to see tomorrow. Lots of fun stuff. So I went through that much faster than I expected, actually. So do you have any questions about what we've covered? Really, none? So, well, let me, you had a question?
Well, I'm just curious, I just noticed one of the calls was when you binded the event listener,
mm-hmm.
it was a function was bind as event listener, and previous I've just seen just bind. Is there a difference between those calls? Is that a change in the SDK?
The actual bind function is provided, So in some code snippets we use bind, and others we use bind as listener. If I remember correctly, the actual bind functionality is not part of Mojo, but the copy of prototype that we were using. And we are to not force you to use any particular JavaScript library, we're getting rid of prototype. It'll still be available. So to replace that, we have created our own bind for that specific use case. So basically means less code will have to be loaded by default in apps. And I forget which is which. One's the prototype version and one is our own version. I may have them backwards. I would just look. We keep the samples reasonably up to date. So I'll go take a look at the sample code. So let me ask some questions of you guys. How many people in the room have actually used as their main phone a webOS device? All right. So for the camera, it looks like we had about 3/4 of people raise their hand. That's awesome. So how many of you are professional software developers? Now what's interesting is there's people in the room who didn't raise their hand. I find that very interesting. That's really cool. Let's see. What else should I ask? So how many of you are going to be here tomorrow? Is there anyone who's not going to be here tomorrow? One guy, two guys. OK, I think that's good. Do you have any other questions about the platform in general? Yes. Yes. No. So the question was, since we have hybrid applications that let you mix C and C++ with JavaScript, does that mean that JavaScript is not up to the task? There's two primary things we wanted to do. One is if you had an existing game written in C and OpenGL, let you bring it to the webOS. There, it turns out it actually hits a pretty big sweet spot. A lot of people can port over applications very quickly, in a matter of hours in some cases. The other is there are times when you really do need low-level access. And for that, we provide the PDK. For your main application, where it's all about the user interface, not, say, manipulating an image or talking directly to OpenGL hardware, then that's what you want to use. It's not that we think JavaScript itself isn't fast enough. It just doesn't have low-level access. You know, you don't have like dealing with binary data in JavaScript is not that easy. It's just built for a different task. So we think there's a place for both of them, but we always see JavaScript as the primary SDK, and the C is just when you need to drop down for very specific things. Were you going to say something, Dion?
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify on the bind listener.
We're hot.
The distinction is actually both come from prototype.
Oh, they do?
And bind is a generic one, which is just, here, bind this into the context. Bind as event listener, make sure that the argument that your function gets is the correct and current event object. So when you're doing event type things, you normally want to use bind as event listener. If you generically want to bind the scope in JavaScript, that's when you use bind. So that's the difference.
So why would I want to use the event listener version? Is it easier to clean up? Or
So the event listener one will just make sure that if you bind a function to it, the thing that gets passed in is the correct event that's being processing right now. So when you're doing event stuff, so like you're doing something with a mouse, then it'll make sure that the first argument that you get when you get into the function will be the event from the mouse move or what have you.
Okay.
So it just takes care of that stuff cross-browser automatically.
Okay, great.
So it's still a wrapper around bind.
It's still a wrapper around bind, yep.
Yes, you had a question?
Is there a way for an end user to create their own services?
Is there a way for an end user to create their own services? Come back tomorrow. I think we have something to announce around that. Today, the answer is no. Tomorrow. Yes, you had a question?
Yeah, I'm fairly new to this. I stepped into an elevator yesterday, the day before, and I saw somebody with an iPhone playing Scrabble with somebody else on an iPhone.
Yes.
Is that something that is in this web?
Were they playing locally or over the internet? Okay, so the reason I ask is you could use like zero-conf over your LAN, basically. And there are a few PDK apps which do that. For example, if you've seen Shrek Cart, we played that over local Wi-Fi at the booth. And that's just using multicast DNS. Most applications want to communicate over the internet. So you're going to use the same things you would do from a desktop web page, which is you connect to an intermediary server which has web services that you call to log in and do your moves. So similar to, you know, a Facebook application, something like that, where you're communicating over the internet. Yes, you had a question?
Yeah, I'm just curious. I noticed that there is a Java interpreter. Looks like there's a Java interpreter on.
Oh. So the question is, since it appears to be a Java interpreter in the operating system, is that usable by developers? The answer is no. That interpreter is purely an implementation detail of the operating system for a variety of legacy reasons. That will go away. Going forward, you'll be able to write services in JavaScript, essentially. Yes, you had a question? Yes.
Can you modify those in addition, like color or style?
Yes, everything. So first thing to note, when you download the SDK, which hopefully everyone here has done and at least tried running through the tutorial, when you download the SDK, we actually provide the source not only to sample code, but to the Mojo framework itself. And you can actually see all the images and the CSS which define all the buttons. It's very handy when you want to extend or modify a particular button through CSS. So you can add a CSS file to the top of your stage and then override the style of any button as you choose. And it's pure CSS, so all the standard DOM CSS properties work. Yes, you had a question?
Yeah, I saw on the slide that you guys are moving towards HTML5.
Yes. The question was HTML, we're moving towards HTML5, but HTML5 doesn't have, or we don't have web brokers and geolocation APIs yet. That is true. Long term, our plan is to converge with their standards. Currently, we have our own geolocation API, and we plan to support the standard once it's finished. For web workers, I know it's on our roadmap. I don't know exactly where it's going to be. We should talk. I think we're going to talk a little more about the next version of the SDK tomorrow, which will get into the idea of background services. So come back tomorrow. Yes?
Really, really basic. There's an app info.json file.
Mm-hmm.
Can you comment
in JSON? Is Kevin in the room? Kevin, so the question was, can you put comments in a JSON file? Because JSON isn't really a a programming construct in a traditional sense. No, you can't, but he had a really clever way of essentially creating comments. And I think it's on incaseofstairs.com. Incaseofstairs.com. Kevin Decker, who's the main engineer behind our awesome Facebook app, he's got actually a session tomorrow, which I think he'll probably talk about that, and a bunch of JavaScript APIs, helper libraries that he's put together. He found a method for doing comments in JSON. I agree, it's an annoying part of the JSON format.
So, I didn't really tell you what I was doing yet.
So the question is where to put a README file? Is this for end users or for other programmers looking at your source?
Right, for programmers looking at my source and for me looking at it a year later.
Then I would just put a README in the root directory of the code, and just don't include it in your built IPK. So his solution was to create a readme.js where the contents is one big comment. That way it won't have any effect on the performance. Yeah, and put that into your app info. Yeah. Cool. Any other questions? So you're all experts already? Ready to go dive in and put something in the catalog? Yes. Absolutely.
Just to go
plenty
a
time.
Tiny bit deeper. But excuse me, I apologize. Everything in WebOS is async. There's, it's all callbacks and on success and on failure.
Yes.
And there's just an awful lot of that. And so, when you were going through the code, you very quickly showed an
on-success. Yeah, let me bring up a good,
right,
here's a good example. Okay. As with most UI toolkits, there's essentially one thread that the GUI happens in, because there's really only one screen, there's one user, there's only one thread to access that. But you have to do everything very quickly, and if there's something that's going to take time, you don't want it to happen on that thread, because it will block the user interface. So the way most toolkits handle this is with some form of callbacks, which is what we do in Mojo. And so I brought up an example here of the download manager, where this is a single block of code that will go into my assistant, probably an event handler when a user clicked on a button saying upload. And we make the service request, these are all the parameters for it, and then two callback functions. When this is executed at runtime, this essentially tells the system, go make a background thread and go start downloading something. And then at some point in the future, call me back. That way the user interface isn't blocked. And this is going to be a very common pattern throughout, not just through our SDK, but pretty much all event-driven GUI programming is done this way. Only things like games have an actual loop where you're just updating every frame. And there's two kinds of functions. You can create an actual named function and then do the bind trick to turn it into a listener. Or you can use an anonymous function, which is what we're doing here, where I've just attached the function directly to onSuccess and onFailure. And this is the response from that. This is the response from the thing I've asked it to do. So I say, go do this. It does it in a background thread and then comes back with the result. And that's the result there. Now I'm back on the GUI thread, and I can do something else. Does that clarify the basic structure for you? OK, good. Yes, another question.
I'm glad you took me back to that slide. You mentioned the subscribe true.
Thank you. And you mentioned that you can follow, you can get progress on this?
Yes.
Where would you connect up the code to handle the progress?
I was hoping you were going to ask that. Okay, so how would you actually get the progress back? So we're going to actually go to our website here. And whoops, I'm on the wrong screen. Nope, that way. So the first lesson is developer.palm.com is your friend. Please open. And under the dev guide, where was that I'm looking for? Oh, actually, I think that's what I want. Reference library. Everyone's downloading the SDK right now, right? So it's making it so slow. Okay, so which one were we at? This was the download manager, right? So service APIs, let's go to the download manager. And I haven't actually done this, so now we'll find out if I'm a liar or not. So these are the actual methods you can do, and we did the upload method. And this shows you all the parameters for each method. So if I'm downloading something, these are all the things I could put into to the, hold on a second. Bring this over here. So all of these parameters here for the method of upload would be documented in a block. So that's download, cancel download, delete, query, list pending. So the download manager can actually download multiple things at once, and you can cancel things once they've already been started, and you can get the current progress. Upload is what I'm calling. Let's see. Completing, completion code, response string, parameters. If true, upload calls the onSuccess handler periodically with updates during the file upload. So onSuccess, this is everything that will be sent to it. So you can look first for the return value to, excuse me. So you'll get the ticket and the subscribed notification to let you know if more could be coming in the future. And then the return value to know if upload actually completed. And then the same thing for failure. And pretty much all the services should have a little code snippet to describe how it works. Oops. What's the key for play? It's always tricky having two screens here. There we go. OK. Any other questions? Yes?
If you wanted to reference a different controller, how would you actually code that?
Again, you have to ask me a question I don't know the immediate answer to. So the question is, if you wanted to reference a different scene, right, different scene than the one that you're in, how would you do that?
Mojo.controller.stageController.
Well, that will get you the stage. And then to get the individual scene,
active scene?
But that gives you the one that's currently active, right?
Yeah. And what if you wanted to get one that's not active?
So there's a method somewhere to get a scene by name. So framework that I may have to defer this question till later. I don't actually know the answer because it's very rare that you need to do that. Because usually you are transferring control to another scene using push and pop, yep. And you can pass in a data structure or an event or something to that thing. You can give it data. So that serves as the argument. Generally, you don't want any direct reference from one scene to another, because it makes your app harder to manage as the code base grows. And it also creates references that are harder for the garbage collector to clean up. So your app would end up taking up more memory. It would take longer to clean up when the user does quit your app. It's generally a bad idea. Yeah.
And if you're in a multi-stage app,
yes,
you can sometimes want to pass information back and forth between multiple stages, but it's not easy.
Yes, it is not easy to pass data between multiple stages. And I should say this is, I forget what version we are of Mojo. We're continuing to evolve the Mojo framework itself to make it easier to use. You'll see some of the improvements. Actually, later in the day when we cover Aries, it does things a little bit differently. And we're weighing, you know, we're sort of trying out ideas in Aries, and if they work well, then rolling them back into the core SDK. So it will continue to improve and get better. You had a question?
I almost changed my mind about asking it, but it's more of a comment. It looks like this reference you have here is also replicated when you download the SDK.
Yes, this is essentially the docs. These are generated from the source code, and there's a copy of this whole web page in the SDK itself. Yeah. You had a question in the back? So the question was, is there docs for how to do multi-touch? I believe we have some events already specifically for multi-touch. And again, those are going to improve. There are some sessions tomorrow that talk about the event system. And load, please. There we go.
Yeah, Josh, I can probably say something quickly on this.
Yeah.
So currently, WebOS doesn't support multi-touch to the level of tracking each finger independently. There is a way using, in the latest version of WebOS, using browser-native, WebKit-native gesture events to track pinch and zoom and rotation. And those are not adequately docked, but we can get you the information, and we're working to get that information into the docs as we speak. So that's something that came actually in WebOS 1.4 when we sort of inherited some basic multi-touch handling from our move to the latest WebKit. Previous to that, it wasn't available.
And I believe in the PDK, there's access to lower level events, right? Where it just gives you the finger, and you have to do all the gesture recognition
yourself.
Yeah,
the other thing is that full multi-finger tracking is on our roadmap, and it'll be coming in a future release. So.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
Asynchronous nature of the environment. I mean, for touch events, for example, for touch events, asynchronous works really well. But for some applications that need data immediately in order to do anything further, for example, database access stuff, I find myself writing kind of difficult to understand code because the path of the code goes through the callback, and it's
right.
Difficult to read it straight through. And furthermore, if you do any more of that, you're constantly going through callbacks. Is there a style that you can recommend to help us deal with that?
So you probably want to attend. Where was that? So definitely go see Kevin Decker, Adventures in Facebook. A lot of lessons he learned about writing larger applications. In some sense, it's always going to be asynchronous because the database call could take time. and you don't want to block the user interface for that. But there are ways of managing it so that your code doesn't become too spaghetti. What was the other one I was thinking of? Effective JavaScript on WebOS. Start with a high-level overview of JavaScript language features, and then dive into how best leverage those features to create clean, maintainable, and performance-driven JavaScript. And I was looking over the slides yesterday, and there's a lot of really good stuff in there. So I definitely go attend that. That's track number 2 tomorrow at 10 a.m.
Does that have a lot of stuff about database interaction? Or
it's more just tips and tricks on how to make the JavaScript maintainable. You know, because the callback mechanism is used everywhere throughout the SDK, it's a common thing. And how to do it in a way that doesn't impact performance too bad, and things that are likely to really stress out the garbage collector. So I highly recommend that one. Yes?
How many of these will be available as slide sets if you want to just reference one?
I believe we're going to put everything on our website, video and the slides. No, it's not there yet. Absolutely, yes. Yes. There was a question in the back, I believe.
I just had a general question about the conference. Is there any one central place that I can go have a one-on-one interaction with a palm
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. So, is there a central place you can go while you're at the conference to have a one-on-one interaction with an engineer? Yes, there is. We have something called the App Lab. So, if neither of the two sessions at any given time is of interest to you, or you brought in an app that's, you know, there's this one thing you're trying to figure out how to do, you didn't understand it, or you're working in performance, bring it to our App Lab, and we're going to have engineers there, sort of office hours, where you can come in and talk directly with us and ask questions one-on-one. And it's today and tomorrow. It's though you can always email us, and we'll see what we can do. Yes. What do we have a room number on? Well, there's like a sign outside of it, isn't there? So across the big hall, the big entryway here, is a room that's got a big sign called. Does it say App Lab? Yeah, this is App Lab. There's a big colorful sign, and someone will be inside there. We can answer your questions. Yes. Oh, I didn't know we had an IRC channel. That's good. What's the name of it?
Cleverly called Pound WebOS.
Pound WebOS on IRC.
On
great.
Free.
Free?
Freenode.
On Freenode. Okay, good.
You mentioned the PDK for porting over native applications. What seminars would cover most of just grabbing existing like C code and moving it over?
The same ones. So
repeat the question.
Let me see. So the question was, there are sessions on PDK. What would cover just grabbing general C code and porting it over? So this one is more about integration. That's the PDK hybrid apps. Because PDK apps can talk to the JavaScript side and vice versa. Probably. So game development, they're going to cover. Well, it's mainly SDL. I thought we had one that was more, it was like a advice on porting. And that's it, right? Hey, Ben, do we have a session that would, which is the best session if you had C code that you want to port? Optimization under 3D hardware or the game development?
What does the C code do in question?
Is this like a video game or just like a library of math code?
It's
or
an image processing library is what it is.
Okay.
So I don't know that we have the best session in the world on the agenda here. We have sessions that target using SDL, which is primarily for games, but you could also use potentially, depending on the interface of your application, for the UI of your application. So probably the best bet would be to go to the App Lab at the right hour. Greg, where is the sign-up sheet that indicates when people are going to be in there? Okay, so check out the App Lab and look for PDK engineers to be in there and direct your question to them, because we don't have a specific session targeting creating you know, image processing and things with the PDK. Your fallback would be to go to the hybrid session. When's the hybrid session, Josh? PDK hybrid applications is definitely the session you'd want to attend. Okay. But I don't know how much detail it'll go into in the areas that you'd want help with.
Sounds like it'll be a good start.
Definitely, mm-hmm. definitely.
Yes.
Yes, could you go back to the slideshow real quick?
Sure.
So there on top, the first line service request, and you're, is that like calling a class that's on your
Yeah,
web server?
So like the Java equivalent would be sort of like loading up the download manager class in the com.palm package.
Okay, and then you're calling the method upload of that class,
yes.
sort of?
Yes.
Okay, so if I was writing my own client server application, would I do the same thing like that, or how would I call my
So if you're writing a client-server application, then you're talking about a server that's not on the phone, that's elsewhere.
Right, like with the database.
Then normal, you'd create a web service API, XML or JSON, and call it with the usual methods. Download manager probably would be overkill for that. In this case, download manager's advantage is they can actually track downloads, so things that take a long time and then you want status on. You can just do normal AJAX requests, get the result text, and then parse it into JSON or XML as needed.
Okay.
So that wouldn't be any different than typical web coding.
Right. This is just for the Palm classes, and this the service request is just for your own classes, right? And
yes. Yes.
Okay.
Service request is for things built into the OS.
Thank you.
So last question.
No last question. But you're all going to come back after the break, right? Awesome. All right. Thank you for coming. We'll see you in a few minutes.